Well, thank you so much for being here this evening, it being the night before Halloween and all. So Arabic theater in translation, language, culture, and politics. I think that this is possibly the first public discussion specific to the topic of translation for the theater here at NYU Abu Dhabi. And it's my hope that with this panel, we will begin an ongoing conversation about intercultural and interregional theatrical exchange and the role of translation in that process. And before introducing the panelists, I want to thank the NYU Abu Dhabi Institute for hosting this event, which was a labor of love on my part, particularly Phil Kennedy, Reindert Falkenberg, Jason Beckerman, Niels Lewis, Tarek Shehab, and Danielle Cherubin. We're fortunate to have four writers and scholars here, well, three here and one here, who are going to talk about their processes and their experiences of translation for the theater. And they represent two distinctly different models of translation. One, a US playwright and professor based in Beirut, and his collaborator, a Lebanese scholar and professor. And two, a bilingual dramatist based in London with origins in Iraq, who is translating the work of a Syrian playwright based in Beirut, collaborating largely via email and Skype. So I'm going to introduce you to them now and thank you in advance for your patience as we bring one of the panelists who was unable to join us in person into the room via Skype, just in case our connection gets interrupted. So to my far right is Robert Myers, who is a professor of English at the American University of Beirut and former director of the Center for American Studies. He is the author of over a dozen stage plays, including Atwater, Fixin' to Die, The Lynching of Leo Frank, Dead of Night, The Execution of Fred Hampton, Painting Persia, Mesopotamia, and Unmanned, which he adapted and retitled Drone Pilots for BBC's Radio 4. He received a MacArthur grant with Nada Saab and Silk Road Rising Theater in Chicago to co-translate Rituals of Signs and Transformations by Sadala Wanous. In 2013, he produced the English language world premiere of that play at the Babel Theater in Beirut, directed by Sahar Asaf. The translation appears in four plays from Syria, Sadala Wanous, published by CUNY's Siegel Center in New York. Nada Saab is assistant professor of Arabic studies at the Lebanese American University. Her publications on modern Arabic drama include studies on the Syrian playwright Sadala Wanous. Her collaboration with Robert Myers has resulted in the translation of Sadala Wanous's Rituals of Signs and Transformations, as well as Jawad al-Assadi's Baghdadi Bath and Issam Mahfouz's The Dictator, both published by Performing Arts Journal. Abdullah Alkafri, hello Abdullah, is a playwright, journalist, and critic. He graduated from the High Institute of Dramatic Arts Department of Theatrical Studies in Damascus and has participated in many workshops, such as the 18th International Emerging Playwrights Lab at the Royal Court Theater in 2007. Abdullah was awarded first place in the 19th Mohammed Taimur Competition for Theatrical Creativity for his script Damascus Aleppo, which was also shortlisted as a finalist in the BBC competition for Best Translated Work in 2008. He is executive manager of Etijahat Independent Culture, an institution that works to activate the role of independent culture and arts in the process of cultural, political, and social change. Hassan Abdulrazzak is of Iraqi origin, born in Prague and living in London. He trained as a cell and molecular biologist and worked at Imperial College and Harvard University. His first play, Baghdad Wedding, premiered at Soho Theatre London in 2007, was produced in Sydney and in India, and was also broadcast on the BBC Radio 3. He has also written two full-length screenplays and translated several plays from Arabic to English for the Royal Court Theatre. So, welcome to Abu Dhabi. So first I'm going to ask Robert to talk to us a little bit about his experience as a translator and also a scholar of plays. Robert is also a playwright, so he brings a particular perspective to translating dramatic works. Robert.
Thank you, Catherine, and thank you very much to NYU Abu Dhabi. which has done an absolutely marvelous job of making us feel at home. So thank you very much. It's wonderful to be here from Beirut. My background, as Catherine said, is principally as a playwright. I've written plays that are they're mostly deal with historical content, political themes, and especially those dramatizing sort of darker episodes that are left out of American history or left out frequently of official stories. It may be because I grew up in the Jim Crow South, so I saw up close and personal a very dark part of American history. I've done a good bit of translating, but most of it's from Portuguese into English, including an essay I published in the New York Times that was by the Brazilian singer Caetano Veloso about the significance of Carmen Miranda, the film star for Brazilian cultural figures. Nada and I were both trained as literary critics. We both went to graduate school. And it's something that we both have found that we can really apply in this process, that it works extraordinarily well, the critical methods, especially of medieval literature. I was trained by a medievalist, Maria Rosa Menocal, and that's one of Nada's areas. I was reading some essays about translation and came upon an observation by Gregory Rabassa, who's the celebrated translator of 100 Years of Solitude by Gabriel Garcia Marquez. And Rabassa says, quote, "The translator, like the critic and scholar, must be a reader, a rare breed, for a translation ought to be the closest possible reading of a work." That, I think, describes in broad terms what our relationship is we get together and close read Arabic plays. We have very complementary skills. Her focus is principally, though not exclusively, in medieval Arabic literature, I just told you about mine. We also have a shared interest in politics and political history and the relationship between ideology and the theater. The first play that we translated together is called Hammam Baghdadi, which we entitled Baghdadi Bath by the Iraqi playwright and director Jawad al-Asadi. It's a play about two brothers who are estranged. They're Iraqi brothers who meet in a Turkish bath in Baghdad during the American occupation after the invasion, and it's very much a response to that invasion. I happen to know Jawad rather well, and he was excited about the invasion, which I was not. And one reason he was that he had been exiled because Saddam had killed his brother, and he was told when he was studying in Bulgaria not to return. So he had been outside of Baghdad and Iraq for 30 years. Each of the plays that we have translated together, and we've translated four, has had a distinct rhetorical register. Since Hammam Baghdadi was our first, I think our choice was a bit more unconscious, but I do think that it was influenced by Waiting for Godot, as the play itself was. But I should point out that one of the ironies, of course, is that Waiting for Godot itself was written in French by an Irishman who translated it back into English. So it, in and of itself, is intentionally playing with this estrangement of language and translation. The other thing that we thought about was Sean O'Casey, because the play starts out as a very funny slapstick play between the two brothers, and it takes a very dark turn. In fact, there was a reading done at Dartmouth with the American actor Asif Mandi, who's a wonderful actor. You may have seen him as the Middle East reporter on The Daily Show, if you've seen it. And it was hilarious, and then when the play turns, you know, the audience almost gasps at it. The second play that we translated was The Dictator by the Lebanese playwright Issam Mahfouz. Here, I think we were a little bit more conscious about it. It's subsequently been done recently. It's a two-person play, and it was done recently by the Lebanese director Lena Apiad, I believe it was actually produced in Abu Dhabi, if I'm not mistaken. That, I think, you know, it felt very much like an Ionesco play, so we tried to do it very deadpan. It's a very absurdist play that takes place during a revolution. But here again, Ionesco is a Romanian who wrote in French, and I'm responding to the Ionesco, the rhetoric of Ionesco plays that I know from English. The third play that we did, which we're going to see a clip of here in a second, is Tukus al-Isharat wa Tahawalet, which we translated as Rituals and Signs of Signs and Transformations by the Syrian playwright Sadala Wanous. That play received a full production, as Catherine said, at the Babel Theater in Hamra in Beirut. But what was particularly gratifying for us was that the actors were either Lebanese or from the Lebanese diaspora or from the Arab world, though the play was done in English. And it was fascinating because many of them could read Arabic, speak Arabic, they knew French, there's a French translation in Arabic, and our English translation. So it was an incredible gift for actors to be able to compare the versions. The most recent play is another play which we're working on now, called Al-Ihtisab, The Rape, also by Sadala Wanous, which takes place in the West Bank in 1990. It's a very tough play, as you can imagine from the title. I'd like to just tell you a couple of strategies we use, then show you this clip, and Nada can talk about how they're implemented, because her I think when we talk about the rhetorical details, she can speak to them better than I can. We decided that in an English translation on stage that less is more, and there's a great tendency to explore the outer limits of rhetoric in Arabic theater, hyperbole, a lot of exaggeration. And it tends to slow down drama in English. The second is that in lieu of repetition, and here again, this is something there tends to be a lot of repetition of words in a root system of related words, we try to find an analogy, and one that we have found is simply alliteration, i.e. you're repeating a first letter as opposed to a word over and over again. The third is that we tried to accept the fact that the sort of inherent musicality one finds in Arabic, you also find it in some Romance languages like Italian, Spanish, Portuguese, it's simply not there in English. But there are ways that you can evoke it, and they include, for example, sibilance, i.e. alliteration beginning with S sounds, or onomatopoeia. So again, this isn't necessarily conscious, but we structure it to try to come up with a sound that evokes some of the feeling and not focus exclusively on meaning. One more thing is that we try to remind ourselves that everything must work as dialogue, and we try to avoid declamatory sentences. This is very hard with a playwright like Wanous, who's very Brechtian. You know, he wants to give speeches, but we try to, in the translation to the extent possible, to even if a line appears to be a speech, that it's directed at someone, and that we try to remember that every line is being spoken to someone, by someone, in a particular context. And that can be even if it's a soliloquy, that the character is speaking to him or herself. And as you'll see in this clip, which we are going to play now, in this clip from Rituals and Signs of Transformation, you'll see that there's a couple of long monologues, but we try to maintain the dramatic tension, and then Nada will also talk about some of the rhetorical tools that we employed in English to sort of evoke the Arabic.
as I sway on the edge, and this pulls me. I imagine that at the moment I fall, colored feathers will grow out of my pores. Feathers will sprout from the roots of my soul, blossoming into perfection. I want to cut these harsh ropes, digging into my flesh and suppressing my body. Ropes woven out of modesty and feelings of being filthy. I want to liberate my body, Sheikh Qasim, to untie these ropes that suck the life out of it and repress it. I want it to return to the orbit for which it was born, like roses and leaves. I dream of reaching my inner self and becoming as clear as glass. My heart burns with passion and fervent desires.
Mu'mina.
My name is Almada.
What you say, woman, is unfathomable to any reasonable person. Are you trying to dress up immorality? Do you think you'll find in prostitution what you're searching for? Tell me it's no more than a whim.
A whim? One doesn't overturn one's fate for a whim. According to your norms, what I'm doing must seem deviant and strange.
It's not just my norms, it's everyone.
You're right. And the first station on my journey is to put your norms behind me. I must rid myself from your judgments, labels, and admonitions in order to attain my true self. I must overcome the fear of being violated in order to become acquainted with my body. You have made me and all women into defective, vulnerable beings, susceptible to violation by a word, a glance. You have made it your business to incessantly abuse this imperfection until we all turned into reptiles tearing at one another in a swamp of shackles, appearances, and lies. I have decided to leave this fetid swamp, Sheikh Qasim, and become a seed that can be polluted. I'll rid myself of defectiveness. I'll exist beyond the limits of fear and violation. I doubt that you'll understand me, though it's no longer important if anyone understands
me. You make me dizzy, Almaza. You grasp at sin with a recklessness no woman in the city has ever matched. A person of your determination and power could corrupt a sultanate of women. You're undoing our lives, our system, our future.
So I think Nada now will talk to us a little bit about the rhetoric, and if I, you know, have a thing or two, I'll jump in.
Well, the text itself, as you could see from the English probably, it's very poetic. Sa'adallah Wannous, probably among theater writers who were working in the 70s, in the 80s, and the 90s, used a lot the Arabic register, specifically of medieval Arabic literature. They were very conscious of this. In this specific play, he does write it going back to specific texts in medieval Arabic, specifically Sufi texts and also the Thousand and One Nights. Over here, you see a lot of imagery where she is talking about her emancipation, the emancipation of her body, her body becoming something like one with all facets of nature that she sees around. You will see similar forms of unison where one feels one with the world in Sufi literature. Now she does that through imagery over here, but also through the use of some terminology. And you probably saw that she says that the first station in my journey is the awwal maqam fi rahlati. By the way, there is another character, her husband, whom she was divorced from, becomes a Sufi. He is actually a son of a Sufi, and he goes back to his own heritage. So they are playing parallel to each other. The person who is emancipating his own soul, returning to his origin, and she is also emancipating herself through emancipation of the body, and they are parallel to one another. Now the Sheikh, of course, comes from the other form, who is, you know, the formalistic religion. It's this mainstream religion. I will leave it to Robert to speak about the English, how he has transformed, tried to use some of the similes or the sounds of the Arabic, like, for example, she talks about her feelings of emancipation. She wants to cut off all ropes. She says, أريد أن أقطع الأمراس الليفية الخشنة التي تحفر لحمي وتقمع جسدي. أمراس مجدولة من الرعب والحشمة والعفة ومشاعر الدنس والقدارة من المواعظ والآيات والتحذيرات والأمثال ووصايا الأسلاف. أريد يا شيخ قاسم أن أعتق جسدي وأفك عنه هذه الجبال, الجمال التي تمتص دمه وتقمعه. Anyway, I will leave it to Robert to discuss some of the aspects.
Well, show me actually.
Okay, maybe. أن يغدو حراً وأن يستقر في مداره الذي خلق له كالورد وأوراق الشجر. We also worked on this. كالقمر
وأعشاب الأرض. Well, you know, in this case, what we did, this is, seems like a good example, for example. In lieu of this inherent musicality that you can see, I mean, this monologue is like a piece of music, which you can't really realistically reproduce in English. We try to find a register which is sort of a Shakespearean register, but not as inaccessible as the Elizabethan, as Elizabethan English would be, but an older, a kind of a 19th century Shakespeare. The play takes place in the 1880s. So, for example, here there's a litany of images of like roses and leaves, like the moon and grass, like gazelles and springs trickling down slopes. Well, this is the rhetoric of Abraham Lincoln. This is the rhetoric of the King James Bible. This is the rhetoric of Ernest Hemingway. It's a litany, and this, and this, and this, and it has a kind of a forward motion in English, but it does not. You do lose quite a bit of the music in translation, and frequently my friends who are Arabic speakers will focus on what's lost. And I, you know, I quite agree with them. There's quite a bit lost, and therefore you have to come up at certain moments with strategies for, well, what could you do in this language that you can't do in that language? And it's not strictly a question of meaning.
Yeah. Let me ask you just a couple of questions, if you don't mind, before we move on. You're talking a great deal about the language, which is absolutely fascinating, and I'm wondering, what happens, what has happened when you put those words in the mouths of English-speaking actors? What was your experience of hearing that? And you know, you've heard it a few times, right? You worked with the actors in Beirut on the production. You had a reading in New York. You had a reading in Chicago, correct? So what was your overall experience, and what kind of walls did you hit when you had transferred that poetry into an English medium?
Did you want to answer that?
Well, I don't know if I felt, I mean, the actors certainly felt quite touched by the characters themselves. I don't know whether we talked, I mean, what was very, this is only a small part. There is another part where the Sufi language, the Sufi lingua is very apparent there. And for someone who is not really knowledgeable about, you know, these parallelisms, mm-hmm. sometimes they wouldn't exactly get how to put that on stage. And so we had to work a lot on, you know, the history of where this text comes from, so that uh-huh. they give the right mood or the right affection that was needed. So
right. So you, then, by talking to them about where yeah, the origins of the language, you helped to deepen their understanding of what Wanous was trying to do. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, it taught us not to presume. In Beirut, where you might presume that people would know quite a bit about Sufism, like mm-hmm. some of the centers of Sufism are in Halab, for example, very nearby. So you might simply assume that a large number of actors in the theater in Lebanon will know a good bit about Sufism. Mm-hmm. That's not necessarily true, nor does that, you know, is it an absolute requirement of the play, but it is, certainly you're going to get a much more informed performance if people have some understanding of what Sufism is as a kind of heterodox version. You know, it also, one huge difference, I think, is that people in Beirut versus, say, New York and Chicago is a real broad understanding of the spectrums of Islam. This is a play that is between two sheikhs, right, as Nadda's saying, in Damascus in 1880. And you see such a wide range of behavior. You know, you see servants drinking arak, you have a character who becomes a prostitute, you have open male homosexuality, you have this kind of range of things that might be, a source of great shock to a North American audience. And we found actually in Beirut, people were far less surprised. They've simply accepted that part of it without fail.
Was there a response in Chicago or New York to those themes being in the play, that as though people were surprised?
Yes, I felt that, to me it's somewhat odd, but I think it's probably a function of the prism through which North Americans have seen this part of the world in grosso modo in the last 10 or 15 years, which is to say, the starting point is 10 or 15 years ago instead of, 1,000 years ago. Why they start, yes, I suppose if you start 10 or 15 years ago. Mm-hmm. But then a lot of the people who were involved were Arab Americans who either knew already, who speak the language, who have a great understanding of this part of the world. So it varied a lot depending on the actor, depending on the audience. But, for us, what we discovered was that this play really travels, that it speaks to people not only in the Arab-speaking world. Yeah. I mean, it's a part of the permanent repertoire of the Comédie Française now, for example.
Wonderful.
The play speaks to people.
But it also, just what you were talking about, brings up the topic of cultural translation, which is also going to be part of our conversation tonight. We're going to get to that with Hassan as well in a moment. But right now I'm going to actually move on to Abdullah, who is still with us. From Beirut, Abdullah.
Good evening, everyone from Beirut. First, I would like to thank you all for coming. I know it's not easy to make things virtually, but at the end, it's reality, so we have to handle it. And can I please let me say hello to Junaid, Omar, Ashen, Lamia, Maya, they are among you. Hello, guys. And today I will talk about my play, Mrs. Gada's In Threshold, but also a little bit about Damascus Aleppo. And then I will talk about translating Edward Albee's The Zoo Story and Carol Churchill's Seven Jewish Children. So please, Hassan, the first slide.
Excellent.
Well, in this text, Mrs. Gada's In Threshold, I was trying to explore the period before the latest changes in Syria, through the narration of the social aspects of human relations and the way they interact with the city and its charger. It explores the relation, between plastic surgery, the city, and the memory. The text is developed on the social media website Facebook between May 2009 and May 2011. It revolves around Mrs. Gada, which is a 42-year-old Messinian woman who's trying her luck at success one last time. After a love story that ends up with a losing marriage, and after the failure in connecting with family in hopes of stability, Gada is used to be a victim of her memory, of her own memory. Her failure to connect with her mother, her family, father, or people in general is reflected on her body with its fat parts. While on the edge of this depression, Gada meets Anas, a dentist who's trying to battle his reality one more time. This meeting is about a potential of meeting or the let's say it's like the potential of a new relation within the city. At the same time, there's someone on Facebook is trying to write about Gada on his own account, although she doesn't know him. Number two, please, Hassan. Second slide.
Yes.
So Ghada is determined to keep on fighting her past and is trying to gain the presence by attacking her harsh memory and paying for a liposuction. Her attempts to redefine herself can be considered her last attempt to make a reconciliation with the city. While on this route, she meets Rabia, who is a plastic surgeon who enters her life and tries to help her move forward. Ghada, who wants to get rid of her past, is fighting at the moment her own memories of Anas, who is being protective of her. And she enters the zone of no return, as she said to Rabia, the plastic surgeon. She can even move on to start a new relation once she finished with this procedure of the liposuction. So, aside from this story, there is also, or I try to explore a series of relations that can take the text to next level, let's say, or add a meaning to it that extends beyond the personal of the story to become a story. It's a story of a city, a chance, and a hypocritical hope. So the text was a choice that expresses the city of Damascus, which is experiencing a dramatic change in its civic society on all aspects, politically, culturally, and economically. Number three, please, Hassan.
Yes.
So the characters here are feeling under the command of a central regime that works in reproducing the hard atmosphere of loneliness, fear, racism, which all are details that push us, or push the characters, I mean, towards a singular ending that is both painful and meaningless. And so yesterday, while I was listening to the reading, I just explored the same feelings again.
Just to interrupt, Abdullah, just to say that this play has been translated. We're going to talk about the English version of the play and your experience of that. And we read through the play last night, just so that the playwright and translator could hear it in the new language. Sorry, go ahead.
Thank you. So, like with the work of Hassan, the great work of Hassan, I was asking myself, I came with this translation, is it the fate of the people of this society to lose one after the other? Or what does the characters of this play have to be able to define themselves when this violence that's faced by Ghada can be dangerous, is considered as driven by political reasons only? Because that six characters live with us and have its own share of the destructive violence. So the subject is paired with a social mediator, which is what a big something in Syria. Since it was banned till 2010, it was banned to use the Facebook or to have an account, or you need like a proxy or something to be able to serve this social website. And so it was like paired with the social mediator and the urban complex relations in Damascus, and produced by this civic factor, which indicates that the fragile balance which is Damascus used to face 3 or 4 years ago, and it was a result of this massive accumulation of errors over the past years. So I'm not going to talk about the play itself. This is like behind the ideas behind the play that I worked on it when I decided to work the play. And I think later on, when Hassan will talk about the process on this long journey of working through the Skype, the email, and yesterday the reading, maybe we can come back and add more. Next slide, please, Hassan.
Yes.
Here it's Dramaturge, which is a play I wrote in 2009. It was the world premiere of it. It was in 2011 in Edinburgh and in Glasgow by the Scottish National Theatre. The play is about Aina, a 55-year-old psychiatrist. His homosexual son has disappeared, and as a result, his home life is falling apart. Then Ayman starts counseling the man who he believed was having a relation with his son. Through this play and through the translation, the big task was how to make the play as an exploration of homosexuality, the family, and the hard face of middle class Damascene life, how they can handle, and for audience, they just heard about Syria once or twice through the media, how to bring this peace and avoiding all possible cliche or typical stories, and to present it and keep focusing on the dramatic component of it. I remember after the first premiere, there was a very nice lady came and say, "Thank you very much. Honestly, I used to believe that Damascus just exists in the Bible, not in reality." So, and suddenly this story comes from Damascus, and there was the mission through the translation. It was how to strike a balance between focusing on only the artistic or the dramatic component, at the same time dealing with all this lake of information, which is first of all not the responsibility of the play itself or the text itself. So it was a lot of work, but here also we think the process that I've been part of the rehearsal with Philip Howard, who's already having experience because he wrote this play, Damascus, and he premiered the play in many cities around the world. And then the team itself and the whole process of a long-term project was led by the Royal Court and the dramaturge David Brake, who helped a lot about creating, let's say, atmosphere for focusing on the play or provide all information we need to talk about the play, or to make it in the best way, or in the best potential way to present it and focus only on the artistic component and create like this dialogue with the audience there. Hassan, the next one, please.
Yes.
Ah.
Here are, yes, the zoo story. And I would like to start from, quoting Jerry from the zoo story with a line I really liked. And it was like, for all the time, it was something thinking about it. He used to say, "I had tried to love and I had tried to kill. And both had been unsuccessful by themselves." And this line, it was kind of like during working on this play. Well, in this play, the original text, I mean, Jerry decides one morning to put an end to more than 30 years of suffering and isolation. Instead of hanging himself to the ceiling of his room, he hides a knife into his pocket and make up his mind to go to the zoo, that it would be the last place he passes through on his way to the North Tower Central Park, where he meets Jeff Peter, who for years is used to sit on a specific bench reading books at Sunday afternoon. This is the way that I summarized the play, and it was the idea that we said, okay, let's make this play possible in Damascus, 2010. A man in his early 40s, working in publishing house, married, having two daughters, two parrots, and two cats. Things seemed to start as unusual, in a public park between two men who don't know each other, and the play will end by the death of one of them. So at this performance, and the performance was in Damascus Opera House, the audience, just as Peter was waiting to be told the event of the Zeus story, while waiting, they all unconsciously lived the event that led to the death of one of the characters there. So the story of Jerry's life and the end of this pain, also with the Peter's life, it was kind, which is his life kind of routine and waiting. It becomes to be the light of this city, which is in this case Damascus. The story, it's at the same time we were thinking, and I was the dramaturge within this production, and we start working on the original text, not on the translated one, and I can talk more about that. So the story, it was the story of these two isolated men, where merely meet in a public park, and they try to communicate with each other, but they discover that it was too late, which is the same thing I was thinking about it in Damascus 2010. As Jerry understands the social life that takes place around him, he gets awareness of what is going on or what is happening, and to commit suicide by throwing himself onto his own knife. So the question that with the director and the actors work in, will Peter go back to his bench next Sunday afternoon to read some new lines from his book? So the main goal and the purpose of this play is to ask this question: will the audience adjust their point of view on life in their very own city after watching or witnessing this story?
Abdullah.
Yes.
So my question is, it sounds like what you're saying is that you were inspired to translate this play because something about the content of the play and the relationship between these two men resonated as something that told the story of Damascus in some way. And so that's your inspiration for deciding to translate. So how, when you moved it from English into Arabic, did it resonate in Arabic in the same way or a different way from the way you experienced it in English?
Yes. So just before answering this, Catherine, can you, Hassan, please move to the next slide? I think here's like it should be part of the.
It's on.
Yes. So the process, Catherine, that I worked on it was starting from transcription the original text from formal Arabic into the local Arabic dialect, while maintaining the theatrical speech of that character. By this, I aim to making the text friendly, to be more easy to the audience that they will attend the play or and highlight it like the details of its daily life. And then I work on Arabization of the character and the events. Like the play happened in Damascus 2006 in a public park. And then I coming up with the dramatic formula suitable for some of the details of the original text, making them fit to nowadays in Syria. And here I work with American director. He was familiar with the text, and I asked him about the whole detail of the original text, like when Jerry talking about like some questions like, do you have TV? We spend like, I was asking, okay, what does he mean by this question? So we did some research, and we discovered that at that time in New York, there was kind of a big trend about the color TVs. So they become something very trendy, and they start to promote kind of the standard life or the perfect American family, which is a pet, two daughters or two sons, a wife and a man. They are all together sit in the kitchen and enjoying their great day. So we start asking, okay, if we are talking about the master 2010, what it fits to speak about the same context without using the same details? Or if he said that he moved from his home to the Central Park, so what about the Central Park? Is it the same place? So then here we start to see the plan, or the plan of the Central Park, and then we found that the original plan of the Central Park in 1948, how it looks to be, to be able to draw the main or the original journey of Jerry. What about him? How he will be like if he just spent 2 hours or 3 hours just walking and then meet Jerry? At the very beginning of working on this play, I thought with the director and with the actor that we have to find isolated place in the park, in a public park. And then when I saw like the plan of this Central Park, I said, it's not about this. It's about place. It's very open. It's very public, and everyone could be passing by. But what makes this play very important is that although of all these things, this action happens here. Mm-hmm. So knowing all the details helps us to create like a Syrian version that raises the same questions or raising the same problem about what this future in this city could be if we keep dealing with the same way and why keep destroying the middle class in Syria.
Wow, okay.
But what, can I just quickly add something very quick?
Yeah.
When we start working, I read two versions of this play, like in Arabic, I mean. One published in Egypt in 1965, which is very, very, very good. And one published in Kuwait in 2009. We discovered that the one who published in 2009 had many cuts of many parts, especially when Jerry talked about his neighbor or when he talked about his relation with God. And the old one, the old Egyptian translation, it used to be better than, and it used to have almost no cuts at all.
I'm sorry, say that again. Almost no what?
No cuts or no any. There is no lines at all, like removed or just modified or tried to be adapted. When like Jerry talking about his queer neighbor and then saying, okay, this neighbor it could be like the God who doesn't care anymore about the people around him. Like, and this is I think here at this slide there is. There's some part of this play or the adapted text we work in it. I am not living in your building. I am not married to these birds or to your girls. I am a permanent transit, and my place is in the clean rooming house, the rented one in the suburbs of Damascus, the oldest inhabited capital in the world. So, knowing very well New York and the place and knowing the context helped us to find this kind of rewriting for the place. And
correlation.
When we just performed the play, the people, some audience come and say, how come Edward Albee wrote about Damascus in this way? So it was a little bit hard to explain the whole journey of this working, starting from the original text, comparing like this translation, and then find with the same condition more and more something equal to our nowadays in Damascus 2010.
Great, Good. Wow.
Hassan, could you please move to like slide number 10 kindly?
Slide 10, yes.
Seven. This is part from the text which I wrote in. You see how difficult it is to find something to deal with the street, with the crowd, with the pack of playing cards, with pornographic pictures, with a wooden box that has no love, with love, with bombing, with crying, with your body that you use for making money, which is an act of love, and I can prove it. With parking because you are alive, with God who's my neighbor, the queen who wears a kimono and plucks his eyebrow, who's the lady who cries all the time behind her door, with God who turned his back on the whole thing some time ago to people where there is a better place to start from to understand and possibly be understood. So this part was removed from the published version in 2009. Mm-hmm. It was in the Egyptian version, and we decided to bring it back and rewrite it in this way in the Syrian version.
Great. Good. Yeah. Wow. We're going to move on. I want to hear a little bit from Hassan about his work with your text, because this is a new relationship, a new working relationship that we want to hear about. Now that we've actually heard your draft of the play, Mrs. Gatta's Pain Threshold, maybe you could just talk a little bit about that process and whatever you wanted to talk about.
First of all, I wanted to thank you for inviting me to this campus, which is really wonderful, and I enjoyed sort of my stay here. It reminds me a lot of J.G. Ballard's novels, where it's always somebody arrives to this kind of utopian place, and then after a while discovers that they're all kind of having bizarre sex and taking some weird experimental drugs, and then they all kill each other for sport. Unfortunately, I'm leaving tomorrow, so I don't have time to find out if that goes on here.
Right.
I came to translation through a very odd route. I am a scientist, and I sort of became a playwright, and then I started translating. And the first play that came my way was from the Royal Court Theater, and I was offered a variety of different Arab plays, and I chose a play called 603 by Imad Farajin. And it's a play that is about four men who are in Ashkelon prison in Israel, who keep hearing this bus that arrives, and they think they're going to be exchanged for this Israeli soldier, except that never materializes. And as their hopes get dashed over time, they start to turn in on each other. Now the characters did not have real names in terms of like Ahmed or Mohammed or something. They were called Abu something. Abu in Arabic is the father of. And it works well in Arabic because it's kind of a nickname. But we made a choice to go a bit more abstract and give the characters kind of odd nicknames that maintained something of their relationship. So they became Boxman, who's a guy who's always carrying this box mysteriously, but then later you find that has artifacts about his daughter. These are all prisoners, of course, characters. Mosquito, who's sort of very obsessed about, he keeps a mosquito as a pet that sucks on his blood, and he feeds her on his blood. A guy called Slap, who has been kicked with the butt of a rifle by an Israeli soldier, so he's kind of gone mad, and he's always gets into this hysterics about being slapped. And the main character, the snake, who's very different from the rest of them and makes different choices. So I'll just read to you a short extract of the beginning where I struggled, but then I kind of found a way to try and capture the kind of slight Palestinian sense of humor of it. So the light goes up gradually. Everyone is sleeping in the cell except Mosquito, who is holding a plastic cup. He is tapping on it a variety of rhythms quietly. He has an empty matchbox open on the floor. He is scanning the room for a mosquito. He looks up towards the ceiling. A mosquito appears and flies into the open matchbox. Mosquito closes the box and goes back to bed. Boxman takes out a plastic cup from his box. He places it on the floor to listen, then he moves to somewhere else. And Boxman begins to talk. The buses are here, the buses are here. On my mom's honor, the buses are here. Mosquito and slap wake up. Snakes carries on sleeping. Come here, listen to the sound of the buses. There are buses coming to take us. That's it, boys. It looks like they're about to exchange us for Gilad Shalad, the Israeli soldier. Come here, listen. We're leaving. We're going home. The letter was true. We're going to be released this week. Mosquito and Slap go to listen. Mosquito puts his ear to the cup. Mosquito, God, it does sound like buses. Slap, let me listen. I think it's the sound of buses. Boxman, man, it is the sound of buses. Mosquito, it's clear now, 100%. It is the sound of buses. Slap, brothers, clearly and surely, it is the sound of buses. Mosquito, I want to say this to you. It is definitely the sounds of buses. The sounds of buses arriving. But I also hear women. Boxman, what? Mosquito, women laughing. Boxman, maybe they're the drivers. Mosquito, I tell you women, you tell me drivers. Boxman, women could be drivers, man. The world has changed. Your mind is still set to 9 years ago. Today, everything is different. Mosquito, you really think they'd use women drivers to transport inmates who spent at least 8 years inside? That guy's in here who could impregnate a rock. Boxman, man, you're so removed from reality. Give it here. I want to listen. And so it carries on. This play was fun to translate. It's comedic, but it also had slight dramaturgical problems. And this is a problem for a playwright who translates, because playwrights, after a while, turn into this kind of maniacal mechanics who just want to take a play apart and rewire it and try and find solutions. But it was an interesting experience, and I got to work with Rufus Norris, the director who's now the artistic director of the National Theatre in London. And after the Royal Court really tried hard to bring a Palestinian play, and it's taken a long time, but finally one will be arriving this year called Fireworks by Dalia Taha. Then I translated several other plays until Abdullah's play came to my attention, also from the Royal Court, Mrs. Gaza's Garda's Pain Threshold. And I loved it. As soon as I read it, I really loved it. And I loved one particular thing about it, which is a problem that we have in London. It was a play about Syria, but it was not really about the Syrian conflict. Of course, he wrote it before, but often theaters in London tend to consider things about the Middle East from that very narrow, you know, what is on the current news. Now, this is partly for kind of commercial reasons, it's for selling and marketing plays, but it's really annoying. And and Abdullah's play, which went to them, maybe he will talk about this, why they didn't end up developing it. I presume, I could be wrong, that it's precisely that they would say, it's not quite relevant to what's happening in Syria now, we can't market this. But this might be a presumption on my part. But I loved it for that particular reason, because it's about this woman who is trapped between her mother that is kind of exerting a force on her and this man that she's trying to connect with and find love and try and get over her husband that she lost in a kind of complicated situation. And she's between these two poles that are exerting pressure on her. And it's a very beautiful play because it's very subtle. There is so much that is not said. And I found that really attractive because it's quite different from how I write. In my play, people go at each other's throat. Maybe this is just something to do with being Iraqi, I don't know. And they kind of go at it. Whereas this one is, a lot of stuff is unsaid. So I kind of had to learn another way of writing to translate this play. And so I'm very grateful for Abdullah, you know, this is a kind of great training for me. I'm going to read you a little extract. So he explained the story that Ghada goes to this plastic surgeon to remove the fat in order to kind of, we almost think as audience that this is to connect with Anas, this other doctor, the dentist that she goes to, and that this is about this new life. But actually, the ghosts of the past are still holding her back. So I'll just read a very short extract. So Ghada says, I don't know why I keep remembering Wajih. Wajih is her husband who died.
I don't know why I keep remembering Wajih. I see his reflection in brass of the Turkish coffee pot. I hear his voice in my head. He lies next to me, silent. I look around me to make sure I'm not going mad. He is silent just as he was in life. I feel his hand on my belly. Why has he come back into my life like this? And Rabih says to her, the plastic surgeons, it means he no longer exists. That's good. Gada takes out a cigarette and lights it. Gada plays with the lighter as she talks. And Gada says, it's like suddenly everything has regained its old meaning. The streets are calm. I climb the stairs quickly like I used to. The high ceilings, Shalom Bakery, Mexican beer, the songs of Abdul Muttalib. What will come after this calm? So that's just a very short excerpt. We had a reading of the play yesterday, which was incredibly useful, and I hope it will get a public reading in New York as planned. So I'll just end on one last thing, which is there's another sort of translation that I've also have done, which is a kind of cultural translation. I wrote my first play, Baghdad Wedding, after being very frustrated of watching the coverage of the Iraq War. I'm originally from Iraq. And there was a kind of a perception of this kind of barbaric people who like to blow things up. And, you know, this, if you were to watch these images, this was the kind of narrative that was coming through. And I wanted to write something that kind of challenged that. But at the same time, it's a play that explained and got an aspect over of Iraqi culture, while at the same time being entertaining to an audience that's used to a different language. Mainly the UK audience, but also I was hoping to kind of non-Iraqi audience of any type. And the play has been performed in Australia and India. I'll just tell you a little bit of it. There is a narrator who talks to the audience, and you'll see a clip called Marwan. He returns to Iraq to join his friend Salim, who's about to get married. But this wedding goes horribly wrong. And then there are two strands of the story. One is Marwan reconnecting with his old love, Luma, who he knew through Salem. And the other thing is Salem's kind of odyssey journey. He is captured by insurgents, and then later he falls in the hands of the American army, the US army. So he goes onto this sort of incredible journey. But the play is very much a black comedy. It always, wherever there's a moment of darkness, it's kind of pierced with a moment of light and humor. And if you can play the clip.
Hurry up! Why haven't you changed?
I have.
You look like you're going to a bloody funeral in that tie. Don't you have a lighter one?
I think I look fantastic.
Adam's right. It's too dark.
See, what did I tell you? You never...
Fine.
Let's just try another one.
Come here. You're a bloody mess.
What's the matter?
Nothing. Well, that scene from your book just popped into my head.
Which scene?
You know, when a friend carried on those two guys. What's the line? Rebecca is not here, mate. It's brilliant.
Yeah, well, I don't think it's funny anymore.
Well, why is that?
It's time to move on.
You've been thinking about what we discussed, haven't you?
What did you discuss?
How Salim should start tackling Iraq, the war. This whole mess.
When I tried to write about Iraq, about my first trip back in 2003.
That was crazy. He just disappeared.
I had to be here. I needed to see it for myself, this new chapter unfolding.
Then remember that long email you wrote? Breathing the intoxicating...
Oxygen of freedom, yes, don't remind me.
Oxygen il hurria.
See, I wasn't the only one who used it. When I try to write, it's a constant struggle to pin down what I feel about all that has happened. I feel like I'm trapped in other writers' worlds.
Well, that's true even for me. And I know Iraq inside out. I worry sometimes whether I've written the same column twice.
I am like Martin Amis, swashbuckling with cliches.
It's early days for you. You are lucky. Novelists are allowed to ruminate. Journalists, on the other hand, are expected to churn. Churn. Time to get another country.
That's not going to happen. Zina is already dreaming of habits.
Shame. Come on, time to make a move. Tidy yourself up.
Salim, I know I've said this to you before. It's not too late to change your mind.
We've been through all this.
Habania is dangerous.
Come on, where is your spirit of adventure? Habania is barely an hour's drive. We could run around there like children again. Uh-huh. Maybe climb a few palm trees.
Shaya fellow, Mr. Hale, I'm over.
stream of memories. It was the place where the middle-class Baghdadis went for picnics and family outings. Salim wanted the wedding there, in that place so strongly associated with happy childhood memories. So there we were, making our way to Habaniya. Kadum and I were near the front of the motorcade. Zina and her family were several cars behind in a white Mercedes decorated with ribbons and balloons. The rear were Salim and his cousins on a pickup truck. Dancing, singing, drinking, firing shots in the air. A wedding is not a wedding in Iraq unless shots are fired. It's like in England, where a wedding is not a wedding unless somebody pukes or tries to kill the bridesmaids. It's just the way it goes. Then I could see it, like a giant bug coming up on the horizon, this American Apache. It dropped and headed our way. I thought it would fly a couple of times over us, then bug it off. Not a chance. I remember finding it hard to breathe when I saw the flare of the missile being fired. I ducked, which is pathetic if you think about it. The missile whizzed over my car and exploded somewhere behind us. It was as if a rhinoceros had butted a motorcade and sent it reeling forth. I couldn't control the wheel, the car skidded this way and that. I veered off the road and landed in a ditch. When I looked behind.
And then also something you mentioned earlier, and this has to do with cultural translation, that the behavior of the people in the play was not what audiences expected.
Yes, so I mean, first it was inspired by a real event, which is a bombing of a wedding caravan. Actually, it's quite funny because I was inspired by an event that happened in Afghanistan. And as I wrote it, a real bombing happened in Iraq as well. So that was sort of odd. But in terms of the cultural translation, so first, for a lot of English audiences, and I'm talking people who go to the theater regularly and people who read, this was a complete surprise. They had a completely different image of what Iraqi society could be like. I, of course, don't make any claim that I'm representing all Iraqi society or anything like that. I wrote about the segment of the study that I know and that I grew up amongst. And so the play challenged a lot of that. Particularly the character of Salim, he's bisexual, as was hinted in the opening scene, and that develops later into the play. But there's also a lot of drinking, extramarital sex, and so on. All of it that happens in kind of secretive ways, but it's there. It was also shocking to some Iraqis. Some other Iraqis recognized themselves in it, but for some, they were like, what is this? No, Iraqis, we don't drink. And I'm like, you've never heard of arak, you know, our type of ouzo? And they go, yeah, okay, we've heard of arak, but I've never seen anybody drink it. I said, well, I've seen a lot of people drink it. I've had a good night on it. So there was this kind of negotiation of what it is to me, it means to be Iraqi. So it kind of translated something from me to both, like, try to communicate to the people where I live in London, but also try to communicate it to Iraqis who, some of whom tend to kind of try and not deal with those aspects of the world of Iraq.
Good evening. This question is really to all of the panel. Working in translation, I know translating humor is especially very difficult, and I was wondering if anyone could speak specifically to the problems they've encountered with doing so, and also perhaps the techniques they developed in order to translate humor effectively, not only to a new language, but into a new culture as well.
Okay, sometimes it can be difficult. With 603, I encountered some problems in that translation because it was a comedic play, but it relied on a kind of humor that just specifically sort of works often in Arabic. A slight turn of phrase, things like that. But you can find strategies to get that. It usually involves a kind of workshopping and getting actors to get into the mood of it and get the speed right. But for example, the exchange I read, I'm no actor. You know, it can be, the extract can be very funny if it's performed well, and get something of the Palestinianness, if you like, of the characters without losing too much. There are certain jokes that often that cannot happen. And so you have to find an equivalent. And there I would make sometimes more radical changes to get that across, if it was important to get that love, or alternatively mm-hmm. lose it. But I often try not to lose it. I try to be faithful to that and find, you know, and try and be drastic in it. With Abdullah's play, there's also humor, although it's a very sort of serious play. But Abdullah's play is structured in a way that I don't think causes any problems. I mean, he does things that I do in my writing and now.
Oh dear. Is that you? Oh, you dropped it.
Yeah.
Okay.
An Iraqi guy, he's got a explosive sounds. With Abdullah's play, he would do things like he'd have this kind of very serious monologue. And then and you get into it, and it's got emotions, and it sort of takes you to and then he would burst it mm-hmm. with a line, either coming from another character or a comment by the character themselves. A lot of the comedy worked in that way. Well, that is not an unusual way for even anyone to play, and it's a sort of technique I use myself as well. So that was quite easy and natural to capture the humor.
Actually, we were hoping to talk about a little bit about this play of The Dictator by Issam Mahfouz, and we ran into this sort of problem. It is a kind of high humor, and it's based on the Arabic language, and maybe Nada could read a little bit of the Arabic, and then we'll tell you what the solution we came up with was, though don't expect to fall on the floor laughing. If you don't laugh, it's okay. So tell them what this, we can put it up on the screen.
Just to give a short introduction, the play actually was written in something which Issam Mahfouz had made up, which is called Al-Fusha Al-Sha'biya. I don't know if you know the difference between Fusha and Ammiya. Fusha is a formal way of speaking. It is entrenched in medieval Arabic. The way people speak on an everyday language is not the same way. It's basically the kind of difference between Shakespearean language and the way you would speak right now. Anyway, Issam Mahfouz had this experiment. He said that theater must speak the daily language. It cannot speak Fusha, even though with Nus thought that no, Fusha is the medium of theater. Anyway, he wrote it, and even though he is actually a poet whose tools are language, what he does is he works on the sounds of words. Arabic vocabulary is all derivational. That means you have a root system, and then words derive out of a root system. The forms have sounds, and the sound itself has meaning, like fa'lan has meaning, fa'lun has meaning. It is a sound that means either active, participle, whatnot.
Oh,
so there is a certain dialogue which really works according to these derivational systems and sounds. Let me go back. Where is it? It is actually written, it looks, many times I go to my students and I ask them to read that. Some of them read it in Fusha, others read it in colloquial, not knowing that this is actually a made-up Fusha that sounds like colloquial. So I will go to where they start playing a game. They play a game which they call the game of names. So I will, if you don't mind, I will read just a little bit of Arabic for those who know Arabic. Are there many people who understand Arabic here? Okay, well, I will read it. It's a very short thing in Arabic, and then I will explain what's going on. Okay, so Sa'dun. There are Sa'dun and General, the characters. لا تتركني يا جنرالي. نسيت إنك خلصتني. الجنرال. طبعاً أنا خلصتك. سعدون. خلصني. أرجوك تخلصني. إذا تركتني أكلوني. الجنرال. خلصك من مين؟ سعدون. من الناس. الجنرال أي ناس؟ سعدون الناس كل الناس اكتب لي أسميهم ساعدون الكل الجنرال الكل ساعدون معقول الجنرال لعبة حلوة ساعدون أي لعبة الجنرال لعبة الأسماء تعال نلعبها ساعدون كيف الجنرال تذكر أول اسم خطر ببالك ساعدون ساعدون الجنرال هيدا اسمك فتش على اسم غيرك ساعدون نيرون الجنرال دايما على وزن فعلون غير ساعدون فعلان الجنرال هيدا اسم ساعدون حمدان الجنرال برافو ساعدون دورك الجنرال سلمان عدنان قحطان سحبان قبلان تعبان زهقان نعسان Now if you go back the translation actually I will just see the translation here the names that they came up with are actually Sa'dun, we translated it to Nero, Natos, Gratos, Pacificus, Betus, Aridus, Tractus, Receptus, Lassus, Tediousness. Anyway, the words are actually derived in Arabic from, of course, Sa'dun's name is Sa'dun. They play this game, Sa'dun asks, gives his name. The general asks him, well, that's your name, you should give some other name, and so he gives the name Neirun. Neirun is actually Nero. And he is making this allusion that the general, who is a ruthless, who wants to be a ruthless king, he is making this allusions between the general and Neirun. So the general doesn't like this game. So he asks him to change it. So Sa'dun changes it to, well, you can't use always Fa'alun form, Fa'alun has no meaning, it's just the sound of the word. So he says, you can't use always Fa'alun, change. And so he gives Fa'alan. Fa'alan has no meaning, it's also a structure of the sound. So they go back to Hamdan, Salman. Yes, Hamdan and Salman both are names, but they are also derived from roots that mean to be grateful and to be peaceful. And I also can't but help, you know, also making the connections between Muhammad and Islam. Then he says, Adnan, Qahtan. Adnan, Qahtan are actually the original tribes from which the tribes of Arabia originated, the northern and the southern Arabs. But they also have connections with the word Adan and Qaht Adan, which means something that is angelic, something that is belongs to, you know, heaven, or arids, the desert comes from Qaht. And so then they, Salman, Qahtan, Adnan, and then Na'san, Zahan, sleepy, tired, da-da. Well, what we first thought is that, well, the words mean sleepy, tired,
yeah, da-da. We
thought of the seven dwarves.
We thought of the seven dwarves, and we said that wouldn't work. Was dopey and sleepy.
Actually,
we decided for the highbrow.
We stayed at that piece. I mean, we translated the whole play. But that specific piece, we worked on it for about 6 months until suddenly every minute, every time we would sit and we would go through
and
the derivations and the sounds and the da-da-da, and then eventually we came up with this, you know, the Latin actually,
mm-hmm.
which follows it, and it shows somehow the sort of game that was going on. So
I'll make sure to ask my question in Arabic for Mr. Myers said, for fear of what may be lost. the question is for all of them, for all the panel. كم تصادفون تلك التيمة التي تناولها سعد الله والنوس في طقوس الإشارات والتحولات تيمة الانعتاق الجسدي؟ هل تعتقدون أنها منتشرة في المسرح العربي كما في المسرح الونوسي إذا صح التعبير؟ شكرا.
Should I answer in Arabic or English? he's talking about emancipation, whether body emancipation is spoken just as in general Arabic theater as it is in Wannous's play. To tell you the truth, this probably brings us to censorship, which we thought we would talk about, and we didn't. This play, when we first showed that this play in New York and in Chicago, one of the very first questions that were asked was that, did this play show in Damascus or anywhere in the Arab world, because this is a woman who turns into a prostitute, into a high-end prostitute. The first scene shows a love scene between her and her, between her husband and another prostitute. So even, I didn't see the play at first, I just read it, and when I first read it, I saw, well, it begins with a sex scene, how could he do that? That can never be put on stage. But anyway, it played normally in Syria for several times. It first played in Beirut, and it was fine. There was no, the topic itself, yes, it is new, and there was fear that it might be censored. However, the sexuality was not censored at all. What was censored was the mufti, because then the man you saw him, and the man who proposed was actually a mufti. The Arabic show in Beirut, when it first showed, he was not called the mufti, he was called the sheikh. And even in our translation, we called him Sheikh Hassan, because if you translate it into mufti, I mean, you cannot put that on stage and explain, you know, what the mufti is. A sheikh is more understood. So anyway, yes, it played. Now, the only time that it was censored is a few years ago. It played again several nights in Damascus, and then it went to Aleppo. The mufti of Aleppo objected. He didn't like that. He heard something about the sexuality, which was very implicit in this play, and he ordered that it be banned, and it was banned. But is there sexuality that is open as such? Well, you will find in some cases, yes, it is used, but possibly more in comedies, where there are lots of sexual jokes. There is something that we call chansonnier, مش الشانسونيير, مسرح الساعة العاشرة, and it is a lot, it has a lot of sexuality and open sexuality in that. But not necessarily this type of literature. This literature is written by very educated men who know medieval literature, who know their language very well. They know the Western tradition very well. And actually, this type of drama is very difficult to read. It's the audience, anyway, is a very elite audience. It's a very elite educated audience. And so when you translate it, in our case, when we have to translate it, we have to play the role of scholars and of very educated readers in order to really make the same structure work in English, because the language in Arabic, as I said, I mean, it has its own nature, and it is idiomatic. The sound has a lot of meaning. It's derivational, and the playwrights are really working the Arabic language. The nature of the Arabic language is quite embedded in the text. So how do you bring that into English? And we have to keep working, I mean, just go over the translation over and over and over again. And we do, in many cases, we do fight a lot, because there are some aspects which are really intrinsic in the Arabic text and they cannot be erased in English. So I go and, you know, this is exactly what's going on. Let's try and so we work on several, you know, versions until we get to a point where we feel that there is the audience reception, at least, is mimicked in English as it is in Arabic. So,
one of the most gratifying things in answer to your question was in the Beirut production, there is a very sort of central plot thread of a relationship between two men, and they're tough guys. And one of them expresses his love for the other. And the other guy, even though it's a sexual relationship, goes, there's no love between men, get out of here. And just blows the other guy off. And the number of people who kind of came up and said that was sort of the central thread and sort of tied it to the zeitgeist in the Arab world, which is to say this kind of longing for being able to express what's inside of you, that was the character who did that, was to me a real revelation. That was mm-hmm. quite a revelation. And, you know, as Nado said, people weren't, you know, I don't think it would have occurred to the audience in New York or Chicago who thought of themselves as very sophisticated, that that's sort of the spine of the entire piece.
Mm-hmm.
But people who saw it in Beirut interpreted it that way.
Right.
We in Arab, we have taboos. We have three taboos, as you all know, which is religion, politics, and religion, politics, and sex.
Thanks
so much.
Can say the word.
These taboos have been crossed, have been approached by Western society, but we still struggle with them. But lately, our artists, translators, they approach those taboos and they cross those lines. We cross the political line, we cross the sex line, now we talk sex in public, even about homosexuality. Do you guys expect that anytime soon we can approach the or cross the third line, which is religion? Can we, at some stage, talk criticize religion in this region? I'm sorry to freak you out.
Yeah, I think it will happen. I mean, I think it should happen. It is the toughest line because we all know with the potential consequences. But I think it's important, not just to burst the, it's not just so much about the daring of bursting that taboo, and oh look, you know, the new frontier, we've crossed it. It's not just about that, it's because it's tied to a lot of other things that are wrong with the society. The way a certain relationship with God has developed, as opposed to other older relationships with God, are mimic a kind of relationship to the family, to the patriarchy, or to rulers of countries. I will not specify more than that. But there is it's tied to a lot of these things. So you're not, if you go for that final frontier, you're going to open up a lot of other things that are tied mm-hmm. to it. Which, in my opinion, are probably more important than that central thing. It's kind of a lid that's on top, sitting on top of a lot of things. It's important. It should happen.
Well, I certainly think that and I obviously they could speak to it better than I. But the very fact that Arabic is a liturgical language and the relationship between language, theatrical language, and liturgical language, by simply interrogating the language, you're right there at the edge of these questions that you're asking. So then, essentially, it's about certain language that can't be used, or is it then body language that can't be used? And theater, historically, I think in all societies, one strand has been talking about what you can't talk about. You know, this is what Doll's House is, and Mrs. Warren's Profession. This is, much of Greek theater is dramatizing what can't be dramatized. And you know, if somebody says, and the way that, like, Rabia Mrouwe deals with it in Lebanon is he simply announces he's doing one-night show, and then, you can't do that. It happened. It did. People did come, and it happened. So... it's happening, but I think the more overt, the more volatile it becomes.
It's also hard to keep a lid on people and artists specifically with all the incredible social media. I mean, the example that I think of is Lucien Bourgeli, who wrote this play, Will It Pass or Not, which is based on his experience of visiting the censor in Lebanon. And as a result of his writing the play, he'd been invited to which festival? The Lyft Festival in London, and his passport was taken from him. But his ability to reach many, many people and get the word out about it had such an impact that he got the passport back in time to go to the Lyft. So I feel as though, you know, it's really hard to keep people down at this point.